SoFloRadio.com. Radio's Dirty Little Secret.
You're listening to The Spot.
Fellas, I'm ready to get up and do my thing.
Flight 305 to Miami is now boarded. There you got it.
Oh yeah. Miami. And just like that, this is The Spot right here on SoFloRadio.com. Appreciate you falling through to The Spot. It's been a long time coming because I know I follow her on Diva Chef Ena's Kitchen. You should definitely check that out on Instagram and on Facebook. It's on Facebook? Yeah, because the one I'm following got your government, so we ain't trying to put that out right now.
No government name.
No government. No, we definitely are honored to have you here because me and Boom were talking about it, my co-host Boom Love out here. It's cool to be around creative. Just listening to you talking about like how you whip up dishes and stuff like that. That to me is no different than an artist that, you know, they just walking down the park and they're whistling and that's an idea for a song. The same type of thing. I always find myself like gravitating to those type of people. Now, how far back does it go for you when it comes to the cooking? Like, when did it start for you?
Seven years old. 7 years old. I used to have to be in the kitchen with my mom. I better have made that rice right.
I feel your pain. Uh-huh. Trust me.
And the interesting thing is that obviously you're Afro-Cuban.
Yes.
So now explain to that like all the things that come with that because, you know, well, because being in South Florida, we're used to the Cuban culture, obviously the pigment different.
Correct.
But you're coming from a different standpoint with it. Like, could you explain that?
I really don't know because when I went to Cuba a couple of years ago, maybe like 2-3 years ago, there is no like it is here where the white Cubans this way, the black Cubans that way. Over there, everybody's like a melting pot.
Okay.
Right. You know, so there's no difference over there.
And it's a lot of black Cubans.
And it's in the majority rules.
A lot of them.
Yeah. Mm. And for every white Cuban, there's black.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So the influence, I would imagine, because I obviously read your bio, arroz con pollo, that's a natural dish across the board.
Yeah.
You know, but were there any other dishes that kind of influenced you?
I think what got me for real was my mom made this thing called harina con cangrejo, which is like polenta with crab, and it was and okra, and it was so delicious.
Mm.
I said, man, I need to learn how to make this. And everybody always rant and raved about my mom's food. But that particular dish just stuck out to me forever. Mm. I never seen her make it again. I just tried to make it one day, and everybody fell in love.
Now, that's a Gemini in her. Just, you know, she got a brash. She got a stunt on everybody because, you know, that you know that's how her mind works. As far as when it comes to the food, right, when you're tasting it, you know, like a foodie, we have a foodie here. When it hits your taste buds or something like that, what's the reaction? Like, is it, okay, I could do something better than that, or I know what I could do with this, or
yes,
they're missing this?
I know what I can do with this. Mm. You know, like, I could tell if it's been store-bought compared to fresh-made.
Mm.
Doesn't necessarily always mean, I mean, I could whip up some mashed potatoes out of a can, and you swear I was in the mashing up some potatoes.
Right, right.
Because it's all about what you put into the food.
True.
Right.
But when did the professional part, like when you were like, okay, I want to go to school for this, or I want to study this?
I actually never went, well, I did go to school a little bit for culinary.
Okay.
But when I lived in Alabama, I lived in rural Alabama, like really.
Like Bama. Bama.
Right. And I caught myself trying to fry chicken. And I used to boil the chicken first, let it cool.
Mm-hmm.
Then I tried to fry it, and my kid's great-grandmother couldn't stop laughing at me. So she showed me how to cook soul food from scratch.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And once I started getting the niche of that,
mm-hmm.
I went to work at a truck stop there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like everything to me. And I was like, yeah, this is what I want to do.
Wow.
You felt it.
Yeah.
That's
crazy. I wish I could see that story. Like, I could see her looking at you like,
She was like, girl, okay. What you doing, girl?
Okay, baby. Come here. I'm going to show you how to make some chicken. That's dope. I think we're going to talk about work.
Huh?
Want to talk about work, the experiences at work?
Oh, yeah. Well, because you are at the Gentlemen's Club.
Yes.
Yes.
Let's talk about, well, first, let's talk about the food before we get into, you know.
The stories?
The stories.
But the stories. Okay.
I just want to learn a little bit about the menu.
Okay.
Because it's interesting to me as someone who doesn't go to a Gentlemen's Club that mm-hmm. it's so crazy that you have such a brilliant menu that people who don't even go to Gentlemen's Club will call you and be like, I want to order X, Y, and Z. So right. Let's talk about your menu there.
I sell lobsters, ribeye steaks, shrimps. My shrimps ain't the little ones. They're the big 8-12 shrimps.
Yeah.
I sell pasta. I make rice, macaroni and cheese. You name it, we sell it.
Mm. Nice. So, yeah, and the Gentlemen Club atmosphere. Mm-hmm. What is that like, being a chef, a female chef, in a Gentlemen's Club Ooh. Atmosphere?
The things you see, I bet.
Yeah. It's interesting. You know, I first started at King of Diamonds.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And that was my first experience ever. Oh, my God. I was so scared at first because you see these girls walking around naked like nothing.
Yeah.
And I used to be like, oh, my God, what's wrong with her? Oh, my God, why she's coming up? Like, and, you know, they get drunk and high and they be all trying to grope you for a chicken wing. I'm not into all of that, the millennial stuff where everybody like your girlfriends walk up to you, be grabbing. I'm not into that.
Yeah.
So when they be like, I be like, yo, like, are you all right? One time this girl chased me all over the club because they knew that I just didn't like that. And then the next day she came and apologized and then we became like the best of friends. But it was an experience.
Yeah.
Now where I'm at right now, the girls are kind of different at the Gentleman's Club where I work at now, G5. So. Mm-hmm. Everybody kind of like stays away from the kitchen. If they come in, they don't come all the way in, but they still come there naked. Yeah, like sometimes I'd be having to say, girl, get that flop from front of my dough. Because they'd be just flopping in the wind.
Yes. Yeah.
Not sanitary.
Right, right.
Hey, can I get me a lobster?
No, not that flop.
That flop.
That be looking like roast beef down there. Girl, get out of here. Your shit, I'm sorry, that's raggedy.
Wow. No, because, I mean, it's a Gentleman's Club, and it's a famous Gentleman's Club. So tell me some of the celebrities, the people that rolled through that you've cooked for.
Well, we'll say the ones.
The ones that you can say.
Okay, well, Scrappy.
Oh, yeah.
He's a good friend of mine. Who's came through there? Jim Jones comes there and gets food. Future has came there just to pick up food.
Nice.
I forgot the football player name, but he took a jet from wherever he was just to come there to get jerk chicken pasta to go wherever he was going.
Wow. So it's just
just a big plethora full of celebrities and athletes.
Now, with all that, again, I'll point out that you are a Gemini. So you have Gemini stuff going on.
I do.
With all that acclaim that you get, like, what does it do to you? Like, it's like, damn, they really, I mean, you know your stuff popping, but it's like people taking jets to come get a plate of food.
I'm
like,
very humble. Like, I'm always grateful for it because I don't really, like, I don't see myself like that. Mm. Like, I could walk in, sometimes I'm in the mall and people are like, that's Chef Ena. Oh, I know. I eat your pasta. Look, can I take a picture? I'm like, no. I don't even know you, you know?
I'm just
so,
going to the mall.
Right. So I just, I'm very grateful.
Mm. Are you always cooking?
Always.
So even at home, like, nobody cooks for you?
Oh, no, what, at home?
Yeah.
I might cook at home once every 3 months.
So who cooks?
Mom, we all eat out.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my daughter.
Oh, my God.
Since she's in love now, you know, she'll cook for her boyfriend, be like, Mom, let you plate. You know, but outside of that.
Yeah.
Cook at home.
Really?
And I cook one holiday, so you better pick which one you want. Christmas or Thanksgiving.
Oh,
okay, so when people actually do cook for you, do you try to hold it in?
Can they cook for you?
You know what I mean? Because, you know, your palate is so advanced. You know what I mean? So I know you're like, you could taste the sweet, the sour, you know what I mean? So is it
I watch them. It is hard.
Yeah.
I watch them and I'd be like, why are you using that? Oh, okay. In my mind, I'd be like, I know I'm not gonna
Okay, Chef Ena's Kitchen, when are we expecting it to open up? Like, what are some of the hurdles that...
Right now, we just got to apply for our license.
Okay.
It's, the construction is done. Yeah, we just need our license. That's it.
That's awesome.
And, like, what is like, a five-year plan? Like, what's the vision you have for it? Franchising? You trying
no,
to
no,
up
no
get...
franchising. Oh. I don't believe in franchising. You know why? Because once you franchise... Everything starts tasting different.
You dilute it.
Yeah. I don't care how much you train them people. Mm. Everything starts tasting different. Prime example, Esther's. Mm. Esther's in the city. The main one was the best one.
Right.
Started franchising here and there. The food just sucked.
Right.
You know, so, no.
Well, is that something, well, you kind of did touch on it as far as how you would run your kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
But is that something you might be concerned with like, other cooks? Because... You can't cook all the time. Sometimes
Correct.
You need a break.
I do.
But your hand is your hand.
Right.
And somebody might, we were just talking about it, like you had a dish downstairs and it wasn't how it was when you last were there.
Yeah. It was.
So is that something that you're concerned with?
Because, all the time. Hmm. And then customers, and I can tell in my numbers, especially the depending on who's in the kitchen cooking, they'll be like, oh, you wasn't at work? I ain't ordering no food.
Oh, my gosh.
Or they'll be calling my phone. That's why I turned my other phone off. Because they will call me throughout the night. They will call me at 6, 7 Jesus. O'clock in the morning. They will call me all day and all night long.
So no boundaries.
No boundaries. When you're coming to work, I want to order my pasta.
Okay.
If you're not there, I can't order it.
What?
Okay, that part ain't going on air. I didn't even see her facial expression, but just going off of you, I was like, okay.
Okay.
All right, we're going to edit that out. But but no, it's definitely, you know, fun to have you here. And as you can see, we like to clown and have fun because, you know, again.
And she has to come back because I still have more questions to ask.
Oh,
her.
Hey, can we talk about work now? Because I want to know about these stripper stories. Like,
but this is off air, right?
No,
because I don't know who he might be listening. I ain't gonna name names, but they gonna know who I'm talking about.
Oh my stories. God.
Well, we're not gonna talk about roast beef bottom.
Oh, there's so many of them. That could be anybody.
Question.
Go ahead.
All right. The person you would most like to cook for.
Wow. Y'all gonna kill me if I say this.
Go ahead. They live?
Wait a minute.
I would hope so.
Do they have to be like another chef? Man, Oprah. No, wait. I would love to cook for Oprah Winfrey.
Nice.
Okay.
She want that bag.
Real.
Yeah.
She want that bag.
But I would love to cook with Paula Deen.
I love Paula Deen.
Paula
I don't care what they say
I don't
about
care what they say about her either.
The woman love
you
daughter.
Can see.
So I'm right.
Yes. Yes.
She does love some
butter. You can see the passion when she cooks.
Yeah.
There's a lot of them that's on TV right now that I'd be looking at their food and I'd be like.
But you're not.
Giada,
you're,
what's her name?
Giada,
the one with the smile.
Yeah. I think her Italian dishes might be really, really good.
Yeah. Half of this stuff, I'm like,
but
I
Rachel
can't
Ray?
Find them. All right, I'm sorry. So you want to go back to her working environment again?
I mean, we got to see if we pass the statute of limitations because there's a lot of things going on, apparently. We don't want to get nobody in trouble.
But, we're
yeah. No, mainly the stories of the guys that got, you know, they came in there looking for love. Or you
Why
know
do
those
men come and look
but
for
they
love?
Don't feel that they get got. They just feel like we broke up and they move on to the next one.
We broke up.
Okay, most girls that I've well I would probably say maybe there's a really small percentage who have regular relationships with regular guys with regular jobs.
Right.
Everybody else is a
Do you really believe that?
Or you know, or something else, you know, that they just want to get what they can get.
It's so funny because, I mean, we were talking about a little bit off air about how men view women in that situation. But it just came to me, women view men differently too.
They do.
Men are the ATM.
You check.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the men feel that you're an object that I can own.
And like you said, pussy holds the power.
Right.
So If you understand that, you could wield that power very well. Now, I'll let you say it. Like, what do you see the types?
Okay. Yeah. Ugly, teeth about this color. Don't look like he bathed ever.
Oh, my God.
But you
God.
Have a title like manager or part owner or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. They love you. And then you feeling like this sense of I can get whoever I want.
Mm. And the girls are...
Within those walls, though. But
right,
they don't
yes.
think
What? They be in there. Everybody share a dick. Okay? And everybody fights over the community dick. Okay? That's
yeah, yeah, yeah. It wow. is.
And it's crazy.
Wow.
Because now you're taking away from my pocket.
Right.
Mm. Right, exactly. Oh, here comes a new girl. Oh, she trying it. It's so... Oh, I be looking at them like...
Oh, my gosh.
These girls are... And then there's this one girl... I called her QP, so she thought I was calling her cute and pretty. I said, nah, girl, you're the queen of polygamy, girl. We need to open up. Every guy can run that bar. That's my brother. That's my brother. How many brothers you got, girl?
Yeah, yeah. That's a big family. That's a
big family. Big family.
Yeah. That's my brother. Yeah. Bringing some sausage meat.
Poor man. It's just so interesting that the men... really
want to get teased and spend your check just to be teased
because
it ain't going nowhere past that.
Yeah,
you know what makes it even funnier?
What?
When you see the dancers, bartenders, everybody except my waitresses taking food orders. I be like, but girl, ain't you supposed to be out there dancing? Well, he wanted to order food first, so I just came in so that they could keep the tip. You understand what I'm saying?
Oh,
that's why they do it.
Oh, I thought they were just like being very helpful.
No,
they
be
resourceful.
They do be helpful to come in there and get their food,
right.
But they keeping the change.
Oh right. my right. God!
So if the steak costs $20, they're telling them it costs $40 or $50, so that way they keep the rest. And they're not
wow.
showing them a menu. Oh, they don't have any menus.
Wow. Tell me, what's your favorite indulgence after a long day at work?
Foot rub.
A fat joint. And a glass of wine.
I love this girl. She, you are amazing.
All right, what type of wine?
Oh, man,
yeah,
I love...
What are you?
I'm getting into the red wines.
I was about to ask
my
about
favorite.
That, yeah.
So, not Merlot, but what's the other one name?
Which one?
Sauvignon Blanc.
Bonk.
Well, no, not Blanc.
No, because that's white.
It's Sauvignon.
Yeah.
Sauvignon somebody.
So a joint and wine. Any other vices? Not vices, but any other relaxing?
Man, I drink Bailey's in 1738. That's my drink, too. That mixed up with my coffee in the morning. That's my elixir to get me going.
What? No Cuban coffee?
You know what? Cuban coffee puts me to sleep.
What?
She's got a reverse... tolerance.
Oh. I do. Cause coffee puts me right to sleep.
There's a lot of people that I've known that after a while, it doesn't do anything but put them to sleep.
Mm-hmm. It's a relaxing agent for me.
No, but that's dope that you are able to internalize it, taste it, and spit it back out and put your little twist to it. So that's definitely a good...
How much do you fall back on your Cuban roots?
That's the base of everything I cook.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I use my Cuban ingredients.
Okay.
Then I add everything else to it. Like, I try to balance it out so it doesn't overpower whatever I'm making.
Right.
You know, because Cuban food is savory. People think Cuban food is spicy, and it's not. Cubans
it's
don't
so
eat spice.
Not.
No, it's not.
It's not.
Oh, my God. If
you
I had a grain of black
them.
Pepper, they'd be like, oh, it's spicy.
Yeah. So. Yeah. It's, and correct
but
me.
It's so flavorful.
Yeah, correct.
Yes.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but it's semi-orgasmic. If you're hungry, like there's a spot I'm giving a lot of people shout outs right now. Free sponsorship. It's a spot in Hialeah called Pollo Norte.
Mm-hmm.
And they made Tarasco steak dipped in eggs, black beans and rice. The itis like kicked in immediately. Like I almost lost my job if I ain't wake up in time because
was your steak breaded?
Yeah, it was
okay,
breaded.
Okay, yeah, be tempanizado.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Empanizado
means.
Empanizado.
Means as breaded.
Yeah. That man.
Cuban food.
That put a lot. And like I said, it's savory because you take it and it's like everybody's like. Oh.
It always makes me do the dance, you know. The
the happy food
dance.
Yeah.
Every time.
Every time.
I think everybody does the happy food dance.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Feel good. Yeah. It's all up in my soul.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you do the happy food dance?
What? All the time. Especially growing up, because where I grew up in Carroll City, across the street from me, Marvin Dixon lived there.
Okay.
So I ate stuff from Sonny's and I didn't know what Sonny's was. Then this was this way. Right across the street, Jamaicans lived there. Man, first time I ever had some dumpling or something, I was like, why my mom doesn't make this?
or some Manish water. You had some Manish water?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah. Oh, man, she sound traumatized.
Yeah. No. When I found out what it was, then it kind of like made me think twice. It's like, eating hog head cheese.
That's the one thing. Yeah, you just don't want to know what's in Manish water. Just take it.
Right.
Or just drink the soup.
Just drink it.
Then the Virgin Islanders right here. Yeah. First time I ever ate curry goat. It was amazing. Then the Puerto Ricans over here. Yeah. So I grew up around a lot of different cultures, and I ate a lot of different things.
Right.
You know, because Cubans, fried chicken, going to Kentucky was a treat. You know, we didn't eat fried chicken.
Right.